Hello and welcome everyone to our latest presentation on the black fungus which is being newly reported in media for the last 2-3 months. Now if you look up in the Google, you'll find hundreds of searches for the black fungus. All the media reports are now focusing on how to treat and what are the tips to prevent this black fungus. So this presentation is on to simplify about what is this black fungus, which is basically mucormycosis. So just to start off, it is a misnomer to call it as a black fungus. The fungus itself isn't black. The eschar or the tissue necrosis which it produces is black in color. So mucormycosis is an infection which is caused by a group of filamentous fungus within the order mucorales and entomophorales. Now these two classes of fungus basically produce this type of an infection in the humans. They occupy the environmental niche like soil, decaying vegetable matters, bread and dust. So basically they are present all around us, and it's not something which is new or something which has been recently discovered. Infection results when the spores enter into the respiratory tract, are ingested in contaminated food or inoculated in the skin through wounds. Now coming to pathogenesis, as we have seen, the disease begins once these spores enter into the system. Now they can also be inoculated inside a healthcare system, and contaminated bandages, medical equipments and ventilation systems. Basically ventilation system here means the AC and the other things like that, not exactly the water humidifier that is being used for oxygenation. It has not yet been isolated from that part. There are incidents of nosocomial outbreaks of mucormycosis as well. But once the spore actually enters the human circulation, the polymorphonuclear cells and the monocytes are very effective in removing the spores and preventing an infection. However, persistence or growth of the organism is facilitated when there is some defect in the phagocytic activity. This can be facilitated by hyperglycemia or acidosis, which impair the chemotaxis and the phagocytic killing. Iron metabolism plays a central role in the pathogenesis of mucormycosis. Patients who have a higher levels of iron are predisposed to develop mucormycosis. Mucormycosis has an affinity for invading blood vessels, with resultant thrombosis and tissue necrosis. As I have already said, it is this tissue necrosis which appears as a black eschar. Now the incidence and epidemiology. If you look at the incidence in epidemiology in India, this is the data from over the last 20 years. We have around 2000 cases which have been reported over this time period. And the most common risk factor remains diabetes. If you look at overall, the incidence is not very high because only 2000 cases in last 20 years. If you look at the causative organism, Rhizopus is the most common organism, followed by Apophysomyces. Now these are the common causative agents which produce mucormycosis in India. Now if you look at children, it is extremely rare to be found in children. Two large international registries over 24 countries identified only 63 cases in over 9 years. So it remains mostly restricted to hematological malignancies. In terms of adults, if you look, the most common risk factor is diabetes, especially if it is poorly controlled with ketoacidosis, followed by hematological malignancy, organ transplant, autoimmune disorders. In COVID patients, the two important risk factors which are present is the diabetes mellitus and the immunosuppressive therapy. The use of steroid also results in higher blood sugar levels, and in some patients also develops ketoacidosis and could be one of the important reasons why these patients are more prone to develop mucormycosis. What are the clinical features? If we look at the clinical features, based on the anatomy, it is classified into 6 forms. That is the rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis, pulmonary, cutaneous, GI, disseminated and uncommon sites. If you look in terms of incidence, it is almost 40% for rhino-orbital, 30% pulmonary, 26% cutaneous, GI and disseminated rest. If we look for the prognosis or the mortality rates for ROCM, which is the most common variety, the mortality ranges from 30 to 50%. This is the data coming out from India. And if we look in terms of GI, it has a very extremely high mortality rate, up to almost 94%. The cutaneous has quite low incidence of mortality, but overall the mortality rate remains around 40 to 60%. If we look specifically into rhinoorbital cerebral mycomycosis, the most common variety, it is a virus. It is when the fungus invades the sinuses and extends into the palate, oral mucosa, orbit, and the bone. Fever, headache, facial pain, nasal congestion, these are common features which are associated especially with the eschar, which can be outside as well as along the mucosa. Orbital invasion is marked by cellulitis, chemosis, proptosis, and evidence of decreased vision. If we look at the scan of the chest for differentiating between mycomycosis and aspergillosis, the most common differentiating factor is the presence of reverse halo sign and more than 10 nodules for mycomycosis. Here we can see the orbital involvement and the eschar tissue formation, especially in the mucosa of the palate as well as in the nasal region, showing the tissue necrosis and the involvement of the orbits. For diagnosis, this is the algorithm which has been recommended. If the patient comes with the ROCM or the pulmonary variety, then we do a CT scan to stage. If the patient has features of brain involvement, we have to go for a MRI. Apart from that, if the patient is from China or India, then there is a high incidence of abdominal symptoms as well. So the patient should undergo ultrasound or an abdominal CT. So once we have done the staging, we have to do a sampling, which is done by the biopsy. And after that, we have to go for direct microscopy and culture. Molecular testing can be done. All of this helps us in specifying the species and finding out what is the organism that is actually causing the infection. If we look for radiological features, this is something which is called the halo sign, which is a consolidation inside followed by a ground glassing area outside. This is called halo sign. This can be present both with aspergillosis as well as mucormycosis. But with mucormycosis specifically, what we see is something called reverse halo. Here inside you find a ground glassing, which is surrounded by an area of consolidation. Apart from that, something which are more specific for mucormycosis is vascular obstructions, extensions across all tissue barriers. Here you see that extension from the spleen through the diaphragm, through the pleura into the lungs. So it doesn't heed to the tissue barriers. Apart from that, this scan shows a progressive increase in the infection of the lungs. So the most important findings for diagnosis are a reverse halo sign, vascular obstruction, and across tissue barrier penetration. If we look in terms of microscopy, then the main differentiation is with aspergillosis. This is aspergillosis. This is mucormycosis. Here you can see the branching is more irregular. Here the marching is more regular, especially divided into two parts. Apart from that, the branching, the septas are more well-defined in aspergillosis, while it is more ill-defined and irregular in mucormycosis. For more specific diagnosis, fluorescent staining is done, in which the measurements of the hyphae helps us in localizing and differentiating it from aspergillosis and between the different species of rhizopus. Now, if we look in terms of therapy, for therapy, the first thing that should be done is surgical debridement. The most important thing that it serves is it results in the control of the disease. The extensive spread is reduced. If you have a huge fungal load, the antifungal therapy cannot work. So we have to reduce the fungal load, reduce the number of area infected, then only we can effectively eradicate the disease. So first thing that we need is surgical debridement, followed by histopathology and microscopic diagnostics, which are helpful if once we have done the surgery. Now, for medical therapy, the treatment that is recommended is liposomal amphotericin B. It is always recommended to start with 10 milligrams per kg and avoid slow escalation of doses. If you are having brain involvement, then definitely start with 10. But if the brain is not involved, you can start with 5. But it is always better if you start with 10 from day 1 itself. Now, if the patient has some renal problem and I cannot start the amphotericin B, then I have to go for IV isavuconazole and posaconazole. The doses are provided over here. If the amphotericin B is unavailable, then we have to go for IV isavuconazole or posaconazole. Apart from that, these therapies like posaconazole oral, amphotericin B less than 5 are not really recommended. And it is always recommended to avoid crystalline forms of amphotericin B. Now, once you have initiated the therapy, you have to check the response by weekly imaging. There can be three responses, that is, the disease is either stable or partially responsive, progressive, or you find some toxicity with the drug. If the disease is stable, you can convert to a peroral isavuconazole or posaconazole. If the disease is progressive, then you can add isavuconazole and posaconazole for a combination therapy. Or if you have already started with 5, then please escalate it to 10. If you find toxicity for amphotericin B, then you have to change over to intravenous isavuconazole or posaconazole. And you can also try for a lesser dose of amphotericin B if there is any toxicity. So thank you for your patience, and check our website for further information. I hope this presentation was helpful in managing mucormycosis.